is a pleasure to be back and finally recording these things once more. This will probably be a little bit sporadic, and this interview has been sitting on the shelf, unfortunately, for about a week now, but I am so glad to be back. I'm still writing every single week and kind of running my rambunctious mouth on Twitter, but I think these interviews are still the most enjoyable part and kind of what started it all. So it really is a pleasure to do such an interview. On this interview, we have Northern Colorado starter, 125-pounder Jace Coulter. Jace, literally from Kansas, a state with not a ton of wrestling history and tradition, so to speak, literally ran the table, won all the Fargo stuff you could possibly imagine at the high school level, and is slowly getting into becoming an amazing starter at an upstart program, Northern Colorado, which, side note, had an amazing senior nationals. And we talk about everything from the differences between Colorado and Kansas, which is very interesting, and kind of how the similarities and differences, and how the recent good news of a senior moment. I'm 17. Some days I feel like I'm 70. The recent good news that this year is going to be a free roll, and he will be able to wrestle and kind of make amends for last season that was not. And also we talk about his blonde hair, which is kind of a part of his identity at this point. This intro has already gone way too long, so without further ado, we'll go ahead and roll the tape with my interview with Jace.
And joining us now through the power of the internet is University of Northern Colorado's 125-pounder Jace Coulter. Let's hope I nailed that. Yeah, how you doing?
Not too bad. How are you doing?
Good, good, good. Well, I guess we'll start with kind of the news that we've kind of all had hopefully a little time to process now, is that this year's kind of a free roll. I mean, So first of all, what's your kind of initial thought on sticking around in college for one more year?
Oh, I mean, yeah, to me, it sounds like a gimme, honestly. I mean, I was pretty exciting news, I think. I think it's fair for a lot of those athletes that it impacted. It impacted so many people, especially last year. I mean, canceling the NCAAs right before the tournament, I mean, that's kind of just a punch in the face, punch in the gut. And just even though they're not right in the wrongs from last year, to be able to give those other athletes that opportunity is huge. I mean, you never know what could happen this season, even if whether we made it through the entire season or not. I mean, we're still missing October, November, December. We're really shooting for that January start. So wouldn't want the same thing to happen and essentially miss out on 2 years of NCAA wrestling. So.
No, I guess having already missed the start of the season, and we aren't really going to get anything until the new calendar. Mm-hmm. How different, I guess, is it on your mind and kind of your routine that this year is different than maybe the past, what you've been wrestling since very, very little?
Yeah, for sure. It's definitely been different. It's kind of I was actually just talking to a lot of my teammates, some of my old buddies from back home, about how weird it is that October through December, we're not really competing. That hasn't been a thing in our lives since we were about 5 years old. So it's just a weird feeling of going, not even really going to class. I mean, it's Zoom classes, stuff like that, but having class and then practicing, but not really knowing what you're training for. It's definitely just a different kind of feel. You almost feel like a fish out of water in a sense. You're just itching to compete all the time. But honestly, I think I've taken huge advantage of it. I think I've made the most strides in my wrestling career thus far right now during quarantine, during the pandemic, whether it was mentally, physically, whatever it was. I think I've just gotten my body back into tip-top shape. I think I'm healthy. My mind's right in the right place. And, especially for my school, I know that we are taking all the necessary steps we need to take, precautionary measures, all those things to really prep ourselves for this season. You know, we're not going super, super hard right now. We're training, we're doing the things necessary that we need to do. And we know when to tell ourselves, you know, we're doing good enough. And, you know, when we think we need to push it a little bit harder, we need to pull back a little bit more. We have that time to kind of gauge and vary and figure stuff out. And, you know, we're trying to peak from the start of the season all the way through the end of the season. I think we're doing a really good job of that right now.
Well, so are y'all still fully online as far as classes and everything is concerned?
We have hybrid classes, and I'd say it's about 60-40. 60% is pretty much all online, and then the other 40 is some form of in-person hybrid kind of class. We really haven't gotten any information for what the second semester is going to look like. I know for me, I have one class that meets in person once a week, and then the other 2 days we're supposed to meet in person. It's on Zoom. And then all my other classes are either fully individual, no Zoom or anything like that, or just Zoom. So, but yeah, other than that, it's just been, it's pretty much all online, I'd say. But
I guess taking it back a little bit, you spent your entire high school career in the state of Kansas, and you've been in Colorado, this will be your third mm-hmm. year, yeah?
Yeah.
I guess, what are kind of the cultural differences between the states, not only like on the mat but also off the mat, that maybe you expected or didn't expect?
I've never really thought of that. I think that in high school I didn't really come from a super powerhouse high school wrestling team or things like that. I always grew up with the same kids club, you know, went into high school knowing I was going to go there. But we didn't have, you know, high level recruits all the time. We kind of built ourselves up from the ground, and we don't have like a long lasting dynasty or legacy of wrestlers at my school. I think that's something we're trying to build right now. Even at our high school, you know, we're still getting better and improving. But to transition from a team that worked really, really hard with what we had to a team with, you know, really high level caliber wrestlers where they're the best from where they're from, anywhere, you know, it was definitely a big change. Just kind of the mindset and how people approach their training, their own, like their own specific training, or how whatever they need to do to be able to prep themselves. I'd say that's the biggest difference. But, you know, you're just in a room full of leaders rather than people that want to look up to you, in a sense, I'd say.
So I guess in your high school career, you had success kind of in all styles and forms of wrestling. Mm-hmm. Is that something that you've prided yourself on, and how did you kind of transition from training and competing seamlessly throughout your career?
I don't know. I think I just knew I really liked all three styles of wrestling, all the main styles here in the U.S. So I think that going from folk style season in the fall and winter was really fun with my high school team. I enjoyed that a lot, and being able to, you know, have the state series and you know, regional, state, all that kind of stuff was a lot of fun. But then I think transitioning into spring and summer wrestling with Team Kansas and a lot of my friends I grew up with wrestling that didn't go to the same high school as me, being able to wrestle freestyle and Greco with them throughout the summer was really motivating. I think that was where I really made my biggest strides, was on the national level, in a sense, in freestyle and Greco. And I think that that's where I enjoyed wrestling really high level and top level competition. I think that's what kept me going and made me want to keep on training and keep on training harder and harder all the time, year round, really.
And then what made you choose Colorado, given you had a lot of other choices, I assume?
Mm-hmm. I really liked, when I came on my visit here, I just enjoyed the entire atmosphere. I actually pictured it, and it reminded me a lot of my high school. You know, we weren't on the map, in a sense, but you look around now, I mean, just tonight we landed a huge recruit, which is really big for us. I mean, Andrew Lira just won senior nationals, Moshe was in the finals, another one of our Northern Colorado Wrestling Club athletes was in the finals out of senior nationals. I mean, we are starting to build something here, and that was something that I really was looking forward to. I think that's something I did in high school, and that was something I was looking to do here. And we're only continuing to get better. We're turning heads constantly. It feels like every single competition, you know, more and more people are starting to notice, and I think that's huge. And I think when I first came on my visit, I noticed the family aspect and the culture aspect of my team was something that I saw within my high school and just how close everybody was. I really enjoyed that, and I love that aspect of that. Not just in wrestling, but the fact that, you know, the team is a family on the outside of the wrestling room. So
you stole the next question straight out of my mouth. I was going to say the RTC and the college aren't doing so bad, right? That's the best couple of weeks they've had in probably a while. I guess seeing other people succeed around you, I guess, what does that do for yourself personally, especially in a time where you haven't competed in a few months?
I think it's so motivating. I'm ecstatic for those guys, but at the same time, it's like, man, I got to step up. I need to start competing just like these guys are. And I think that's something the entire team has done. It's boosted our confidence. You know, our morale's through the roof right now. And I think it's just gotten us so pumped to want to compete and want to get back out there. I think you can kind of handle this whole pandemic in two ways. You can either let it crush you and break you, or you can fight through it, find ways around it, and, you know, get your training in, get your mind right, and build that confidence and morale. And I think that's exactly what we're doing right now. We are definitely on the right track, and we're looking to make some big strides this season.
And I guess, how have you seen the program change in just the 3 years that you've been there?
It has changed immensely. I think that the work ethic, the mentality, I think there was it was a challenge my freshman and redshirt freshman year last year. We've had to fight injuries. We've had to fight, a lot of stuff that had to do with travel or just anything like that. And I think that we kind of let a lot of external factors get to us. And I think that things that were out of our control, we let kind of get into our heads, and things just, you know, started to spiral. One thing led to another. And I think now that shifted to where, oh, this happened. Okay, that's all right. Well, good, moving on. And then I think that we've just figured out how to be able to fight that adversity and overcome it a lot better than we have in the past. I think we all elevate each other, and it's not so much of an individual aspect. It's more of, okay, we move as a unit and we do these things together, and we get through these things together. So, and I think that's huge for our team.
And do you attribute that just to kind of everybody growing another year and experiencing things together, and that like nothing really can teach that, so to speak?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we had a pretty young team last year, and just with that 1 year of experience for all of us that were in the starting lineup, I think we've just come into this season with a fresh new start, coming with a brand new mentality and facing things and how we approach these things. I mean, we were all just, you know, it was my first year in the lineup, really. It's a lot different than high school. And I think we all realize that it's a grind of a season, and it's kind of just how you take it, and you take it in stride and take it one step at a time. And I think that we're just more prepared this year. We're ready. We've faced, we've really faced the worst of it. I mean, you can't really do much worse than getting NCAAs canceled after an entire season. So, yeah.
Yeah. And I guess also you major in psychology, right?
Yep.
That's not, okay. So I guess I love having people that major in psychology on the show, because do you take a lot of the things that you learn in the classroom and kind of think about how they could help you athletically in a way? And I guess what if you have kind of taken your classroom stuff?
Yeah, for sure. I think that so I'm really into psychology and nutrition as well, and I think that I've found a mixture of both of those things that are really beneficial and helpful, because coming into college, I always knew I wanted to take psychology and major in psychology, but I actually never took anything in high school about it. We just didn't really offer a whole bunch of classes for psychology and all that kind of stuff. So whenever I got here, you know, intro to psych, all that kind of stuff, didn't learn a whole bunch that could really influence my sport in a sense. But now that I'm getting into higher level psych classes, I mean, it's huge realizing how much of this stuff, especially sports psychology, you can actually put towards wrestling, or not even just wrestling, but any sport in general, and how much, if you just train your mind to do specific things or think a certain way, and it's more than just, oh, you know, toughen up. Like, you can literally trick your mind into thinking that you're doing things that, you know, you wouldn't think that you could do, or your body couldn't do, or things like that. And it's just taking the things I learned in the classroom that I find incredibly interesting has helped me and impacted my wrestling in a huge way, I think. So
now I wonder, are many of the like traditional sports psychology cliches, like don't think about the score, or you know do things fearlessly, or don't think about such and such, are those actually helpful in a way, or do you think that we've used them so much to the point that they've kind of lost their effect?
I think to an extent, a big one that we have here is just effort, giving effort. It's just all about effort. You know, it seems like it's so simple, but in reality, you know, I come to the same conclusion. It's like, it's not really about how fast you're going or how hard you're going. It's about the amount of effort you're putting in. If you're putting 100% effort, you're going to get better. And even if you doubt that you're getting better, you're going to get better if you're giving everything that you possibly can in everything that you do. So I think to an extent, those cliches, you know, some of them seem like a broken record, but a lot of them, even if they do seem like that, they definitely still hold true. So, yeah, I mean, kind of depends on how you take it. In a sense, you can take it one of two ways.
Yeah. I guess how during a match, especially when matches kind of happen week after week, how much time do you devote to preparing, and how much is it just kind of situational wing, as I like to call it? That's my personal term. But
I'd say for duels, it's definitely, you know, you wrestle a duel, you review it, you sit on it for a little bit, maybe one day, you know, you review film, all that kind of stuff. But then that next week, if you've got another duel, I mean, it's really training for that match. I mean, if you're going into a tournament, yeah, you're trying to really focus on yourself, your skills, your skill set, your techniques, all that kind of stuff. But going into a duel, I think you really need to analyze your opponent and really watch the film. And we have film breakdowns and all that kind of stuff, and being able to know, you know, what situations you might face. I think going over those kinds of situations in practice will definitely help you in the long run for a duel, especially those week-to-week stuff. You can't hang your head on one match, and you also can't, you know, pride yourself on one match, because the next week you've got another higher level wrestler that you're going to have to wrestle, and you got to be ready to go for each and every single match. So hanging on a match is definitely not the way to go. I think taking it in stride and just being able to prepare yourself for each and every single match is definitely the way to go.
Now, you talked about kind of psychology and kind of the ability for someone to trick their mind into doing something that we normally wouldn't think that you'd be able to do. Yeah. When you're wrestling and you're only wrestling like one other person, can you feel like when they're trying to deliberately throw you off? And do you, I guess, if there is such a thing, do you believe in kind of a more prophylactic approach to dealing with them?
I mean, I don't really think that opponents really try and throw you off, I suppose. I think it's just mid-match adjustments, in a sense. You know, things aren't really going your way. You've got to really find the time to – not even find the time, but you got to make an adjustment just like that. I mean, you have to be able to realize what's going on, what's going well, what's going wrong, and, you know, change up your game plan or change up your strategy or whatever it may be. I mean, if you hit the same shot over and over and over again, you're not getting it. You're obviously going to have to change something to be able to get that takedown. So,
and is that something that you've gotten better at over time, you would say?
Yeah, I definitely think so, yeah.
And I guess you said that, you know, y'all had struggles, adversity, whatever you want to call it, your first year in the lineup, but you really seemed to peak at the right time. Mm-hmm. I guess, when did you personally realize that, and it changed kind of from just continuing to push and work for it, and then finally realizing, like, oh, the big moment is actually here?
Mm-hmm. You know, I really just think when the lights are on, we know how to perform. And I think that when it comes down to it, we're able to get gritty, buckle down, and just do what needs to be done, really. We spend the time grinding. We spend all of our time in there doing the most amount of work possible. And I think that we just know when the time is right, and we prepare our bodies, prepare our minds for the right time to peak, and that's when we're going to perform. And I think that, you know, a lot of guys, we push through those adversities, and we realize we went through a lot of struggle to get here. Like, can't just let it go to waste in a sense. And I think that's why we wrestle so well in top-notch moments.
And then as a person that now kind of has looked into psychology, how do you approach writing goals and using the what I think is a pretty arbitrary term? You can define it however you want as goal setting, and especially for next year, given all the chaos that we've had for what seems like forever now.
I think the biggest thing for me when it comes to psychology, I love goal setting. I think it's amazing. I wrote an entire speech on it for my public speaking class, wrote a paper on it for a final in psychology. I think that goal setting and visualization and things like that, knowing you're going to be somewhere in however many days, whatever it is, and whether it's in wrestling or in life or whatever it may be, maybe you want to get some sort of job promotion, or you want to be doing some certain thing by this amount of time, like whatever it may be, you write those goals down and you see it every single day. If you have to write that goal down every single day, you have to put a post-it note on your front door and you look at it every single day, whatever it may be, just continuously putting that into your head and visualizing it. I mean, chances are it's more likely going to happen. I believe in that, at least. I'm a big believer in visualization and stuff like that. And, you know, gravitating yourself towards those goals instead of just mindlessly wandering towards them. If you have a set goal and a directive and an incentive to reach that thing, then you're going to be more gravitated towards it, and it's going to pull you right back in.
And is public speaking something that you're also kind of drawn to just naturally, having been?
Yeah, a lot of people are really scared of public speaking. I don't really mind it, honestly. I think it's something that is definitely difficult still. It's not easy by any means, but it's just something that if you're passionate about something, I feel like you should be able to talk about it in front of a larger group of people, whether you're nervous. Obviously, you're going to get nervous, but if it's something you're passionate about, then don't be afraid to talk about it and really get up there and, you know, do your thing.
I guess it's
not really something that I'm not pursuing it. I would love to do like motivational speaking and stuff like that. I think that's why I really like the aspect of psychology and being able to understand individuals. So, I mean, whenever those time comes for public speaking, like motivational speaking and stuff like that.
I guess when all is said and done, college only lasts a set amount of time for people. And supposedly these years seem to go by faster than you think. So when all is said and done, where are you going to be at?
I don't really know, honestly. I'm hoping I want to compete on the senior circuit. That's, my biggest goal. That's definitely where I want to be. I think that's where I plan on being. After that, I love to coach. I love to be doing something with psychology. Honestly, I think for myself, I have a lot of options. I'm not going to set my mind to any one thing right now. I think that's, you've only got one shot at this whole thing. So I think doing what you want to do, and whether you change that 3-4 times within your lifetime, as long as you're happy, then, you know, just keep doing it. Do what you want to do. But, you know, especially right now, and, you know, probably for the next 10 years or so, whatever it may be, you know, I'm still young. I've got a lot of wrestling left in me, and I truly believe that. So I want to hit that senior circuit and really be successful on there. So.
And I guess now that it's almost been half an hour, and, you know, people can't put up with my voice for too long. It's not pretty. I get it. but I always end with one kind of fun one. When was bleaching your hair a thing? And I guess, when do you decide to do it and when not to do it?
So I've actually been bleaching my hair since I was 5 years old. It's just been a tradition for me. I remember the very first year I made state, it was my very first year wrestling. I was 5 years old and we bleached my hair. We actually just put highlights in it. And ever since then, I was always bleaching my hair pretty much every year for state. I do different colors, whatever, but I always came back to that. The bleaching is just, you know, tradition. I think it's a wrestling thing in general. And there was one year, my eighth grade year, right before high school, me and two other kids from my kids club wanted to grow mullets. And we just decided, we're like, all right, we're going to grow these mullets out. And we did. Two of us stuck with it. His hair actually gets way longer than mine, but I'm the only one that really kept that mullet in a sense. And ever since my eighth grade year, every summer I'd have that bleach blonde mullet, and I think that was almost trademark. I think if you ask people, you know, who I am, I think they'd probably be like, oh, the kid with the blonde mullet, and they'd be like, yeah, that's him. But yeah, I don't know. I think I really like it. It's almost become like a part of me now, and I think that kind of want to bring that back. So I think I might just, for the first time, I think I'm going to keep it for this season and see how things go. I like it. A lot of my teammates like it. So my coach always jokes around with me and says that's the reason you recruited me. So, I mean, might as well bring that back.
Oh, man. I can't even fathom pulling off either blonde hair or mullets, but we'll save that. We'll save that for another time. Well, any last parting words before I let you go and enjoy the rest of your evening?
I just appreciate you having me on, man. It was a pleasure. I love it. So appreciate you being so involved in the wrestling world. And, you know, I just appreciate you having me on.
Thank you so much. You have a great evening.
Will do. Thank you, man. You too.
It's been a pleasure.
Thank you so much for tuning in to this episode of The Mental Takedown. And as I said in the intro, it has certainly been a pleasure to turn these out again and start interviewing people as we hopefully gear up for another college season. If you did enjoy it, like it, subscribe, do all the influencer stuff that I've never been amazingly good at, and have a great rest of your day. I'll spare you some time since the intro was twice as long. I'll try and keep the outro twice as short. See you soon, and hope you enjoy the rest of your evening.